Welcome to India Inc. On the Move, a virtual summit which is in collaboration with Rockwell Automation. This year's event is focused on the theme on Innovate Your Future, where we are bringing together the manufacturing industry's brightest minds to decode how we can build smart manufacturing ecosystems to gain a competitive edge in the next normal. We have with us an esteemed panel today. So we have Prasenjit Sengupta, who's the Executive Vice President and Chief Digital Officer, Thermax Group. We have Mr. Dilip Soni, who's the MD of Rockwell Automation, Dr. Shailendra Choksi, the Whole-Time Director, JK Lakshmi Cement, and Mr. Ramaswamy, the Chief Digitization Officer at Hindalco Industries. Welcome, gentlemen, to this panel. Well, Mr. Sengupta, let's start this conversation with you. The overall theme about this is basically digitization in heavy industries. So where exactly does India stand when it comes to digitization in heavy industries?
Thank you for the question. If I look at the heavy engineering portion, when we talk about digitalization, let me first talk about digitalization. We have seen that digital has really taken up space in terms of the fast-moving consumer goods, the financial markets, the banking is something that we are conversant with. Then the digitalization wave took over the automotive industry. But when it comes to manufacturing and especially heavy engineering manufacturing, this industry has been the last to take over. And it is not only in India, but worldwide. We see that the engineering and the manufacturing space is moving towards digitalization, but it is last of the block.
Okay. When you say it's last of the block, can you compare where exactly heavy industries stand as compared to other industries when it comes to digitization? How low are we, say, on a scale of 1 to 10?
Let me talk in the language that everybody is talking about. We talk about Industry 4.0, that is a jargon that everybody is talking about. Automotive as an industry has already reached Industry 4.0, which means that you can track every single unit coming out. You can track all the machines. You can track all the, every single unit which is going there in terms of labor, in terms of machines, in terms of parts, in terms of other components. But when it comes to engineering, when it comes to manufacturing, heavy engineering specifically, the entire industry is not process oriented completely. There's a lot of manual interventions that happen. There is a lot of bespoke engineering that happens. And that is one of the biggest reasons why digitalization could not come across in this industry earlier. But I think the way things are moving, the way we are making implementations improvements in the processes, improvements in the discrete manufacturing area, I think it is giving better and better scope for digitizing these areas.
Okay, just to put it into context, if in case auto is at 4, where is heavy engineering on a global scale?
I would say if auto is at 4, then heavy engineering would be somewhere around 2 to 2.5.
Okay, 2 to 2.5 is where heavy engineering is. Mr. Choksi, where would you rate India as compared to its global peers when it comes to heavy engineering? Mr. Sengupta said that we are 2 to 2.5 when compared to autos, which is at 4 in terms of digitization. But compared to our global peers, where do we stand when it comes to heavy engineering?
Yeah, before I answer your, that pointed question, let me tell you, when I talk about heavy industry, it's not just the manufacturing. There are so many pieces which makes a heavy industry run efficiently. There's a procurement, there is a process, obviously, manufacturing process. There are machines, how they work. But there's a whole lot of other pieces, which is the output, its supply chain, and finally, the most important, its customer. So I think in some of the pieces, a lot of work has been done in the manufacturing, be it the procurement, be it the customer piece, be it the supply chain. And yes, in the manufacturing, core manufacturing, in some of the process, We could be slightly lagging behind, but the other pieces that I talked about, we are fairly there. We are fairly there. In fact, some of the pieces we may be ahead.
Okay, and some of the ways we might be ahead. In what way, Mr. Choksi, in what way are we ahead when it comes to our global peers?
You see, talking about my own industry, you know, we are fairly equivalent or comparable to the best as far as the supply chain is concerned. There are a lot of work has been done by the industry in India, and they have really similarly in, I would say, in procurement, a lot of work has been done, and in terms of efficiency, we were already there as a benchmark in terms of our efficiency. But going forward, yes, we will certainly need to match them as far as the digital interface or digital initiatives are concerned to improve it further.
Okay. Mr. Soni, what has your experience been? Because you probably have a bird's eye view in terms of what a lot of companies are probably doing at this point when it comes to digitization and heavy industries. Do you agree that in many ways we are probably in line with global peers when it comes to heavy engineering and digitization? And do you think that we are actually lagging behind compared to, say, other industries?
Yeah, so thanks, Ekta. And I agree with the two perspectives that have already come out from Mr. Choksi as well as from Prasenjit. Heavy industry as a group compared to, say, some of the other industries, automotive does tend to be a little bit of an early adopter when it comes to new technology. So that's all right. But I also agree with Mr. Choksi when he was talking about us being sort of already over there in many aspects compared to the best globally. The one area where I compare and contrast the Indian heavy industry with, say, some of the other competitors that India has is the end-to-end optimization of the enterprises. The advanced economies are far ahead in terms of integrating all of their supply chain, including manufacturing, so that they can optimize at that level and really drive a lot of business value for themselves. That's an area where I think India as an industry can do a lot better. And, while that's a macro level answer, if you double click and look inside, there are an industry, after all, is basically the constituent companies that are out there, right? Organizations, they were probably in a wait and watch stage and not fully committed in terms of taking their first steps, which is perfectly all right, because this is still early days. It's been probably last 5 to 7 years that the industry is bracing up to this phenomenon that we call as digital transformation.
Mr. Ramaswamy, how can manufacturers benefit from predicting maintenance needs? How exactly does that work?
So when you say maintenance needs, again, the fundamental of manufacturing is, do you have your equipment, critical equipments in place? And do you know what are the failure of that particular equipment from your history? Now, if you do not have a good history, you may probably not benefit too much from the predictive maintenance needs. So one is, as an organization, how good are you in having history of your critical equipment? If you have the history, if you have the right data, then that helps you to build very quick predictive asset modeling. For example, typically what you measure in our kind of industry, any industry has got typical types of assets. One is rotating assets, which are motors, compressors, or anything which is rotating, bearing, which are rotating. The second one is static equipments like, rolling mills or the ball mills or the boilers, heaters, these are. So if you categorize your equipments well, apply the right mechanism and the method of model building.
Okay, Mr. Sengupta, would you agree? Do you think that Thermax, there was probably some amount of apprehension, or did you step on the pedal when it came to digitization and took the necessary steps?
We really believe that the digitalization is going to play a very big, impactful role. And it has got the commitment right from the top to the grassroots. And I think that might be one of the single biggest lever that might make or break any digital initiative across any industry.
Okay, Mr. Choksi, would you agree? Was adopting the digital transformation for your supply chain, for your value chain, easy for the company?
I think the biggest thing is the mindset change, which is required to make any transformation exercise successful. And another major catalyst can be your previous successes. So, if you have an organization which is very adapt to learning, which is, very focused on what they want to achieve, I'm sure it is not that difficult, and size really doesn't matter. We are a mid-size in our space. As a group, we are fairly big, but when it comes to the individual business, we are a mid-sized company, and we feel we have done a lot. That does not mean we have reached the end. No, there's huge lot of things that we still need to go, but we are in that journey of the transformation.
All right, Mr. Ramaswamy, what's the extent of resource optimization and increase in operational efficiency that we can look at through the usage of industrial Internet of Things?
So first, let me take one by one. So the first one I said is about availability of the plant. So here, important is whatever assets you have, and irrespective of the manufacturing, are they fit for use and are they available to you 100% of the time? So here you use the predictive maintenance because of IoT, where you build models to basically prevent any failures of your equipments in advance so that you don't have a downtime of your shop floor. That's number one. So this, now how much efficiency will you gain? If you are one of the best run companies, maybe you will gain 2 to 3% efficiency. If you're one of those average companies that is probably not so good in your practices, you may gain around 4 to 5%. If you're really bad, maybe you have much more. But I would say 2 to 3% efficiency gain you get by just making sure that your equipments and your assets are always running, number one. Number two, when you look at quality, all of us know that when the resources are utilized and you produce, are whatever you produce, is it fit to ship to the customer? Many of us do have rejections in the shop floor, both in-house and customer rejects. Now, there could be a factor of 1 to 2% rejections, a reduction in rejection that you can get if you apply the data analytics on improving the quality proactively. So when I'm talking about IoT, I'm always looking at using IoT to be more proactive. Using your data, can you become more proactive? So by looking at the quality more proactively and optimizing the process, you could probably gain 1 or 2% improvement in the quality of your products to the customer. Again, it depends on which your industry is. Are you in the average performance, low performance, or high performance? But that's the kind of gains you can get. The third one is consistently running your shop floor at the cost. So cost optimization for companies like ours, for example, in metals or aluminum, it becomes very important. Are you really able to produce the product at a very reasonable and low cost always? For that, in addition to controlling your equipments, in addition to controlling your quality, what you do run is consistently are you able to run the production in the cycle times that you have programmed it to be.
Okay, mindset change, that's the biggest thing. Mr. Soni, would you agree? Mindset change, that would mean a lot of employees adapting to it. So there's a human element which comes into digital transformation as well. Do you think that India has more of that to adopt as compared to, say, our global peers?
So, I couldn't agree more with what's being discussed. I think fundamentally digital transformation is not just technology, but it's basically the adoption of that technology in transforming the entire business to gain, game-changing advantages, right? Unlocking a lot of value, gaining agility, right? Having the ability to run your organization with, one common data set, which is one version of truth, right? So, but these things they sound very easy when they're spoken. They are very, very hard when you have to implement them, across the various layers of the organization, across various functions, organizations, particularly large organizations in industries, heavier industries in particular, they end up being very significant operations. The value at stake is very large. There's large capex, opex budgets, large big workforces, right? You know, so to take an entire ecosystem and people along with you to implement that that change is easier said than done, and it takes a lot of commitment, but it is well worth the effort. So that would be my take.
But do you think that's the biggest challenge, the human element?
I would say it's one of the more significant challenges. I wouldn't say that that's the only challenge, but it's a very significant part of the overall set of considerations that you need to have in mind when you embark on a digital transformation journey.
Okay, let's talk about specific. Sure, go ahead.
Now, I was about to say is the other or a challenge which is bigger than that is just having a clarity of purpose. You know, you got to really know why do you want to commit yourself to a change as significant as that, and not just the a few people in the leadership team, but the entire leadership team of the organization needs to be quite clear-minded about it. So it is leveraging technology, but it's not just about technology. It's about how you go about running your business operations. And okay. if you're not willing to push your the boundaries of how you run your operations and commit yourself to that change, the value that you may get out of it would be quite incremental or insignificant, right? And on the other hand, the worst case scenario could be you could be inducing a lot of change without actually getting the big upside of the value unlock.
All right, Mr. Ramaswamy, how tough are these technologies for the workforce to adopt? Should there be a necessary training to get them on board?
So let's look at workforce. Workforce really doesn't bother about the technology. What they need is, tell me what is the change in the practice. So when you took a look at, let's look at workforce in three different buckets, right? One are the people who operate the machines on the shop floor, who are trained how to operate the machines. Now, they don't need to know these technologies. The second layer of people are the supervisors who actually manage to run the daily production or daily quality. And third level is the engineers or the process engineers who really are the people who know about the process. Now, when you talk about training and skill building, it's important that you build different skills at these three different layers. What's important at the operator layer is, what are the practices that is going to change because I've implemented a prediction model? They have to be told that when you get an alert or when you get a simple alarms, what action should you take, which is different than what you're doing till yesterday. So you have to basically teach them the difference in methods. They don't need to learn analytics, okay? Second is the supervisor. Supervisors have to be told that when the alerts comes or when the data throws some anomalies, they have to help the operators analyze it and help take timely decisions. Because you could get great alerts, great alarms from your IoT, but if you do not take appropriate actions, it's of no use. So you have to educate the supervisors on how does that asset work? How does the model work? What kind of alarms and alerts it's going to throw? How the data will look? And so hence, when I look at the particular data, how to interpret the outcome and what action should I take? So you should train them on what actions to take. The third layer is the process engineers, who should be actually taught about continuously building the model as the processes keep changing. Because in a manufacturing, you don't have the process is always not static, right? It keeps changing depending on what you produce, depending on the weather, depending on the climate. The process parameters do change. So when you do change the process parameters, these process engineers have to be educated on how do you rebuild the model. Of course, the model building will be done by the data scientists, but process engineers should know that it's time for them to rebuild the model. Go to the data scientist. So he should know how to build the model. He need not build the model himself, but he should be trained on how models get built. He should be trained on how you look at critical parameters. He should be trained on the data trends and patterns, and he should be trained on what actions he has to take.
Okay, actually, you know, I just wanted to extend that point forward, Mr. Soni, because you said that there should be a clarity of purpose when you digitize. And there is this fear that people also over-digitize. You have deep pockets, you know you can spend the money, you're a large company, you've had legacy issues, you want to take that next step and that next leap when it comes to becoming one of the more digitized companies, a better value chain. So do companies tend to over-digitize, and there should be maybe some balance when it comes to manual operations versus digitization? Have you seen that in your experience?
Let me answer it in the following manner, Ekta. You know, anytime you find that you're implementing a digital transformation, program or an initiative, you know, with that as the end, you should just simply stop and reassess. Your end objective really has to be a business-oriented end objective, a business outcome. So, you know, it's not about technology at all. It really is about the business outcome that you're trying to achieve, which may require simpler or, you know, more complex set of technologies. I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Mr. Choksi, tell us, give us an example in terms of what you might have implemented in the past 5 years when it comes to digitization for your company, for JK Lakshmi, and how it has changed things on the ground. Give us an example of how realistically you've managed to adopt digitization and how it's changed your business.
Sure. You know, the business that we are in, that is the cement, it's very freight intensive industry. Freight is by far the largest of the cost which is there. Now, earlier the life was very simple. We simply had the, where the material had to go. We had a certain set of transporters. And then we used to, you know, the factory would continuously produce, and he would send the material wherever there are the orders are. Machine learning, and you know, you the same supply what we were doing at say, 1100 rupees a ton 3 years back. I have given a very simple answer. Today I would not be doing at more than 850 rupees a ton. So that's the type of gross saving. But there are what you call outcomes, which may not really translate into those rupees per ton cost. I gave a very simple example. But there are instances where simply my customer satisfaction gets enhanced considerably, my process gets improved considerably, I may not have an immediate, you know, saving in terms of rupees per ton. So I think it's gradually you go on expanding your horizon as you get those successes.
Okay, so you've managed to actually save 250 rupees per ton in terms of cost savings, probably on a ballpark figure when it comes to digitization, or maybe that's the kind of savings one can see when it comes to digitization. So that would, Mr. Choksi, mean an improvement in margins. That one-time investment in digitization would equal to an eventual improvement in margins?
Eventually, you see, all the decisions that we take as business leaders, they obviously would have, we'll have to calculate a payback period. We would do that. And it makes it all the more easy to take the next initiative and so on. So that is where the mindset gets transformed. Then everybody starts looking at value. So the people, you know, the people like us who were taking earlier decision based on our intuition, our mental capabilities, suddenly we find that work has been outsourced to a machine who works on a model. Now that is the type of mindset changes. And I think that is where what Dilip mentioned about the clarity of the purpose, that is the biggest enabler for achieving this mindset.
Okay.
And therefore, I and that's why when you were discussing the possibility of over-digitization, I was actually quite surprised that if I am taking up any initiative, any transformation initiative, for a particular outcome, for a particular business case, then it is the choice of the tool that I take, that is where the maximum time gets spent. And that is where, you know, at my level, as being one of the director in charge of the business, I spend a lot of time seeing which is the best technology, which will be the best fit case. I could still go wrong. But that is where we spend a lot of time. And once we are doing that, then I think the fear of over-digitization probably may not be there.
Okay, Mr. Sawhney, would you like to respond to that?
No, I completely agree. I couldn't agree more because, you know, what Mr. Choksi has laid out is some real-life value unlock, you know, use cases. Perfect example that he just cited. You know, I completely concur.
Okay, Mr. Sengupta, you know, coming to you, give us a real-life example in terms of how digitization has changed things around for Thermax. Say, in the past 3 to 4 years, any new steps which have been adopted by all?
See, when we were looking at digitalization, we were primarily looking at 3 or 4 factors. One is, does it help me in reaching out to the customers better, faster, increase my top line? Second is, can it improve my processes, improve my costs, the way I am operating businesses? The third one being, that does it open up different revenue channels, completely different business models? And in each one of these areas, we have basically looked at certain, let us say again, low-hanging fruits to start with, but then also planning a long-term vision. When we are talking about, let us say, implementation, going to the market in terms of putting in analytics, putting in customer relationship systems, putting in dealer management systems, these are some areas which have really helped us in reaching out to the customers. The CRM that I talked to you about has actually helped us in putting all our leads, opportunities, the entire pipeline in a proper focus. So it is a win-win for both. Our customers really get top class, fast service, and we ourselves are in a much better position to ensure that the efficiencies and uptimes are controlled, and we are in a position to also guarantee to a certain extent the efficiencies and uptimes of our products and our sites. So that is an area that we are working on now, but these are pretty much some areas across those three differentiators that we want our digitalization to bring about.
Okay, fair enough. So things which took weeks now take days to do, and that's because of digitization. Mr. Sawhney, you know, heavy industries comprises of power, cement, metals, mining, water. Tell us where has digitization probably advanced the most, and where does it have scope to improve?
Okay, so, you know, what we are categorizing as heavy industries, as like you yourself pointed out, it's a very, very vast basket of industries, and each one with its own challenges. You know, I would say that, you know, progress is being made in all of them. You know, let me just step aside for a minute and point out, you know, what we call as, you know, digital transformation or digitization, right? Essentially, what you are trying to achieve across the entire organization is this notion of a digital thread, right? You know, imagine digital thread as this seamless flow of data that connects the business process across the entire value chain. And once you have established that, it begins to give you an unparalleled view of your organization for the first time. And a lot of things which were, you know, Mr. Choksi was pointing out, you know, what you were previously working on, basis your gut feel, basis experience that you had acquired over years, you know, it suddenly begins to come out as you know, hard facts, data, insights, and sometimes coming out, jumping out at you, you know, almost in real time. You know, we also have equipment makers, large capital equipments like you know, what Prasenji's organization represents, right? You know, which are also becoming very, very contemporary because they are serving the needs of a global industry, right? So the ideas that Prasenjit was laying out, such as remote monitoring, remote diagnostics, you know, these things are no longer, you know, they used to be a handful of years ago, you know, they used to be out there kind of ideas. But right now, particularly, you know, during these pandemic stages, these things have been utilized, you know, far and wide to carry out not just remote diagnostics, but even remote commissioning, right? You know, virtual commissioning, right? You know, so we are already experiencing that the power of digitization and, you know, coupled with the innovative and the human ingenuity, if you want to put it that way, right, you know, is unlocking a lot of new interesting use cases.
Mr. Ramaswamy asks, can artificial intelligence help in risk modeling and risk assessment that could help manufacturers gain a better understanding of equipment related issues?
Of course, yes. So just to build on my previous question that I was answering the previous question, how does artificial intelligence or machine learning help in preventing or mitigating risk of, and I will give you, while you asked about the equipment, let me give you how we can predict or prevent or risk mitigation, okay? One, let's look at on the your critical assets. Critical assets is something that is so important for you that any of the failure of that, even for a few minutes, can cause huge loss to the company. So once you identify the critical assets, if you bring them under the IoT analytics, predictive analytics, I think the risk of whether you'll be able to meet the customer demand, whether your plant is going to run well in the next one day, next one week, I think the prediction, today we are building models which can actually predict failures almost a week in advance. So that's the kind of predictive models that people are building today. Similarly, the same thing you can do even for quality. You know, can you predict that the next 1 week of production that's going to go out of your factory, will it meet the customer requirements upfront? The answer is yes. Again, AML can be used to predict the quality of what is going to go out of your plant. Can you predict the incoming raw material pricing? For example, if you look at my industry, we do buy commodities, right? So my production cost is a conversion cost, but I also depend heavily on my input commodity cost. Now, if I can use AML to predict the commodity pricing, of course, the analytics models have been used for ages, but I think the current technology that's available in using AML, if the predictions are done better, I can even predict the commodity price, which is indirectly my raw material price, and take some decisions on sourcing, whether I could, you know, buy something upfront or should I postpone something to a later date. So that way, the entire value chain, if you apply the AML properly, you could save cost, you could save on wastage, you could improve customer satisfaction, and the prediction could be to the order of 2 to 3 weeks easily. And that's what everybody is attempting, but it's going to take time. And that's how AML can be used.
Okay, Mr. Choksi, I wanted to ask you that how exactly have these digital tools or digitization helped you during the pandemic at a time where your workforce and your factories were probably not at optimum utilization? How exactly did the value chain sustain itself and how did digitization help?
I think very, very important, you know, we had at the time of lockdown declaration on the 23rd March, we had something like 95,000 ton of our material on the roads at a point of time. And many of the trucks were abandoned by those drivers and they left. We had a control on each and every truck by the GPS data that we have today, that we monitor each and every consignment today. And believe me, we did not lose a single bag of cement out of that. You know, if I multiply by that tonnage, if I multiply by 20 to get the number of bags, I think that changed the very way that we used to work. We had the data of most of our customers as to at what stage their project would be. And how can we see that, you know, that consignment that we have on the road, can we park it there so that when they resume the work, when their labor comes back, they are not at least affected for want of cement. So I think we got a huge advantage, I would say, during the pandemic. And of course, I think the biggest transformation which every industry is probably experiencing, that we are today learning to operate without going to your office. And that is only possible when you have a lot of processes, this seamless data available through a common thread, as Dilip just now mentioned earlier.
Okay, well, that's a wonderful example, Mr. Choksi, that you did not lose a single bag of cement. And I think you managed to mobilize 20 lakh cement bags during COVID-19 simply because of the digitization and during the lockdown. But Mr. Sengupta, if you could just give us a brief example on what your experience might have been during COVID.
It was about not only the erstwhile ERP-related, CRM-related processes that we were talking about, but even hardcore manual processes as like engineering that I talked about. Also, another very big learning was that it was not only us who were learning, but even our customers. And that is where even when Dilip was mentioning and about remote commissioning, that was something that we also tried out for the first time and we did it successfully. So we saw there was a very big openness also in terms of our customers to experiment with online business. And I think this entire pandemic, this one and a half years has shown that normal day-to-day business can be run remotely. There are many checks and balances that we have been able to do. I think analytics played a very important part. Our discussions moved completely from physical to offline. Decisions moved on offline. I mean, a whole lot of things actually moved offline. And I think when wave two struck, I think we did not even bat an eyelid, whether it was in terms of orders, whether it was in terms of revenue, whether it was in terms of, as I mentioned, proposals. Everything was being managed offline in a hybrid mode. Wherever we could send people, we were sending people. Wherever we were not able to send people, we were doing it remotely. And I think that has been the big learner of how to continue with business continuity, as we talk about, I think has been the biggest learning advantage in pandemic.
Okay, all right. Well, on that optimistic note, I think we're going to wrap up. But Mr. Soni, I'm going to leave you with the last comment because I know you were quite keen to get in your thoughts with regards to COVID-19 and how digitization helped. Your thoughts on that, as well as the closing comments in terms of what the way forward might be for the heavy industry space when it comes to the digital future.
Sure. So first of all, just building on, I couldn't hold myself back. I totally agree with what Prasenjit mentioned. I think part of the reason why during the first wave of COVID, everyone was able to, was suddenly very open-minded about trying out new things. And I thought, learning over there was once you took away that fear of failure, because, what could go wrong if you tried? As it is, your businesses were shut down completely, right? And if you tried and succeeded, that would have been a big breakthrough. And there we found that a vast majority of these little experiments that all of us collectively undertook, right, enabled by digital, right, a vast majority of those experiments were successful. Everyone tried to do things, on their own. The other thing was everyone was learning from each other. So, instead of people being in that competitive mode, right, people were sharing best practices, learning from each other's best practices. And I thought that was a great, learning in hindsight. So that's one thing which I really, really would like all of us to collectively remember is, remove the fear of failure, be open-minded, look for ideas. And again, technology is not a limiting factor because as we saw it, right, you did not have to be an organization that was the most digitized one out there, right? But as long as you were open-minded and as long as you were courageous to take the first step, you were able to see that, I was able to do this and let me try and take a second step forward. I thought that was very, very well illustrated, even though the times that we were living through was so challenging. So,
you don't mind, you said.
Yes, sure, go ahead.
That's the last comment. On a lighter side, my CIO said, I would like to really repeat that he said that, I'm glad COVID had some positive advantages. The biggest was it was a great facilitator for the buy-in of the people towards the digital initiative.
Absolutely. I think so as well, because it's allowed people to realize that you can work from home and you can work efficiently. So I think maybe there is a little bit of a silver lining to that as well. But Mr. Soni, Mr. Choksi, and Mr. Sengupta, thank you very much for joining in into this panel and discussing what is a topic which will probably require require much more in-depth analysis, which is digitization of heavy industries. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Pleasure. Pleasure.